I remember something that C.D. Brooks said a long time ago. Someone had commented to Brooks. Anybody know who I mean when I say C.D. Brooks?
Yes.
You remember, recognize that name? One of the greatest Adventist preachers. And they said something about him, you know, being a great preacher. He says, no, it's not the man, it's the message. It's the message. The message is what's great. And that's what makes our message so wonderful. It's a great message, friends. And I want to tell you that what you're going to hear tonight, you won't hear at Andrews University. You won't hear at any of the higher schools of theology, but you should.
Yeah.
But what you have tonight is a theological treat because it's the message, it's not the messenger. But we're talking about character perfection. Perfection of our characters. And tonight, our third installment on this is called The Final Generation. Last night we discussed a little bit about the concept of systematic theology. It is a discipline of Christian theology that formulates an orderly, rational, and coherent account of the Christian faith and beliefs. We compared it to having some gears. You have these gears, and if one of these gears is a main drive gear, whatever direction it turns, it affects every other gear. Or if that gear gets a notch or a tooth broke in it, then it affects the way everything else works. And whenever you have certain foundational teachings, friends, and you alter those foundational teachings, you can be sure that everything else up the line is going to be affected just as well. We specifically talked about three areas: soteriology, Christology, and eschatology. Soteriology is a science of salvation, the plan of salvation. Soteria is the Greek word for salvation or being saved. Christology, of course, about the nature of Christ, and that usually includes the Godhead. And eschatology comes from the Greek word eschatos, which means last or last day things. And we made a statement last night. I'd like to review that statement. And it says this, that the Adventist church was raised up to prepare honest seekers of truth to be translated, not to die. Now, I want you to think about that for a minute. If the Adventist church was raised up to prepare people for translation, how many generations should the Advent movement need?
One.
Just one. One generation, friends. God did not intend the Adventist movement to go beyond a generation because only one generation is needed. Now, I said some things last night and perhaps I didn't say enough things, but I'd just like to share a few points quickly tonight to begin with. And the first one's in Colossians chapter 2. Colossians chapter 2 and verse 6. And here the Apostle Paul says, as ye have therefore received Christ Jesus the Lord, so walk ye in Him. Very simple question. How do we receive Jesus Christ?
By faith.
By faith, through the Word of God. And how are we then to walk? By faith, through the Word of God. In Romans chapter 1, verses 16 and 17, there the Apostle Paul is quoting from the book of
Habakkuk,
or Habakkuk as it's probably sometimes pronounced. And he's specifically quoting from chapter 2 and verse
4.
But I want you to notice what he says in Romans about it. Turn back to Romans chapter 1, because we want to put all this in balance. Romans chapter 1. Verse 16, Paul says, for I am not ashamed of the gospel of Christ, for it is the power of God unto salvation to everyone that what?
Believeth.
And the verb form, believe, has a noun counterpart, and that is faith. In other words, when he says to those who believe, we could also say equally accurately to those who have faith. Isn't that right?
Yeah.
But notice what else it says. To everyone that believeth, to the Jew first and also to the Greek, for therein is the righteousness of God revealed. Now that word therein. Therein what?
The gospel.
The gospel. Something's in the gospel and says it's the righteousness of God. And I'd like to suggest to you that Psalms 119 and verse 172 has the answer. All thy commandments are righteousness. Friends, the true gospel of God doesn't eliminate the commandments of God at all. It establishes the law of God. That's what Paul says in Romans chapter 3, verse 31. And then he says, for the just shall live by faith. Some of you maybe missed my meeting on Tuesday night, but there we quoted to you from Testimonies to Ministers, page 508. Divine grace is needed at the beginning. Divine grace at every step of advance, and divine grace alone can complete the work. Notice it's divine grace, divine grace, divine grace. And that's what we need, beloved. We need that divine grace. And the fact is, we needed it right from the very inception of sin. And I'm glad we have it. We've been told that as soon as there was sin, there was a Savior. God had made a provision. If He had not made that provision, friends, we would all be hopelessly lost. We wouldn't even be in here today. As soon as there was sin, there was a Savior. Christ knew what He would have to suffer, yet He became man's substitute. As soon as Adam sinned, the Son of God presented Himself as surety for the human race, with just as much power to avert the doom pronounced upon the guilty as when He died upon the cross of Calvary. Now, I made a statement on Tuesday night, and I'll still stand by that statement, that this campaigning is for me. The messages are for me, and you take care of yourself right now. It's me, O Lord, standing in need of prayer. Not my brother, not my sister, but it's me. I stand in need of prayer tonight. But there's a text in the book of Isaiah. In fact, there's two texts in the book of Isaiah I want you to look at tonight. The first one is in Isaiah chapter 13. Isaiah chapter 13. Friends, is God going to deal with the sin problem?
Yes.
He is going to deal with the sin problem, for sure. In Isaiah chapter 13, verse 9. Isaiah 13, verse 9. Behold, the day of the Lord cometh, cruel, both with wrath and fierce anger. This is from a God of love, friends. Isn't it?
Yes.
It's not a different God, is it? Is the God of the New Testament a different God from the God of the Old Testament? No, they're the same person. Same character that we're supposed to have. But He says here that it's both with wrath and fierce anger to lay the land desolate, and He shall destroy the sinners thereof out of it. And we discussed last night who sinners were. And then it goes on to say, for the stars of heaven and the constellations thereof shall not give their light. The sun shall be darkened in his going forth, and the moon shall not cause her light to shine. And I will punish the world for their evil, and the wickedness for their iniquity. And I will cause the arrogancy of the proud to cease, and will lay low the haughtiness of the terrible. Any of you ever hear Elder Bauer's sermon on this text? Pretty interesting. But you know, this is not where the text finishes. If it finished here, we might be a little discouraged. But let's look at the very next verse. Verse 12, I will make a man more precious than fine gold, even a man than the golden wedge of Ophir. What is God promising to do, beloved? He's promising to change our hearts. He's promising to take the filthiness and the arrogancy from those who will surrender to His plan. The focus, though, sometimes that we have, and again, I do want to say I'm focusing for me tonight, but the good news is I don't have to focus on myself thinking I'm going to be the only one who ever makes it or the only one who's ever lost. But friends, in Isaiah chapter 26, Isaiah chapter 26 and verse 2, we read this. Let's read verse 1 also. In that day shall this song be sung in the land of Judah. We have a strong city. Salvation will God appoint for walls and bulwarks. Open ye the gates. Open ye the gates. That the righteous nation which keepeth the truth may enter in. And He says, thy law is the truth in Psalms 119, verse 142. But here God says, I have more than just a man who's made more precious than the fine golden wedge of Ophir. I have a whole righteous nation. I have a righteous nation that's going to enter, friends. And we can be a part of that righteous nation. Now, again, does God really expect His people to walk as a people this old path, this good path? Does He really look to us as more than just individuals, but as a corpus or as a body? Does He expect this from His church as a whole? Well, He says He has a righteous nation. Turn with me to Ephesians in the New Testament. Ephesians chapter 4. Ephesians chapter 4, and I believe Brother David was reading from this text the other night in verse 13, speaking about spiritual gifts and their benefit, and The perfecting of the saints in verse 13, till we all come in the unity of the faith and of the knowledge of the Son of God into a perfect man, unto the measure of the stature of the fullness of Christ. But notice the second word in verse 13. Till we. That's not singular, is it? It's plural. In chapter 5 of Ephesians, speaking of his church, in verse 26, that he might sanctify and cleanse it with the washing of water by the word, that he might present it to himself a glorious church, not having spot or wrinkle or any such thing, but that it should be holy and without blemish. He's speaking about the church, a collective group of people. And he says he's going to come back for a collective group of people. And they're not going to have spot or wrinkle or any such thing. 2 Peter chapter 3. 2 Peter chapter 3. And we'll start in verse 11. Notice the language. 2 Peter chapter 3. That's near the end of the New Testament. Verse 11. Seeing then that all these things shall be dissolved, what manner of persons ought ye to be in all holy conversation and godliness? Now that little pronoun, ye, that's Old English, and that's better than New English in this case, because we clearly know that this is what?
Second person plural.
Second person plural. It's a plural pronoun. It's not a singular pronoun or a pronoun like we use you today that can be ambiguous. It could be singular, it could be plural. Ye, it's a plural situation. He's not just speaking to a person. He's speaking to all the people here. Verse 12, looking for and hastening unto the coming of the day of God, wherein the heavens being on fire shall be dissolved, and the elements shall melt with fervent heat. Nevertheless, what's the next word?
We.
Who's we?
All of us.
Nevertheless, we, according to his promise, look for a new heavens, or new heavens and a new earth, wherein dwelleth righteousness. And we could look at other texts, 1 John 3, 2 and 3, Revelation chapter 7, 1 through 5, Revelation 14, 1 through 5, and so on. We won't take time to look at those now. But just remember this. In Revelation chapter 12, verse 14, here is the patience of the saint. Of the what?
Saints.
Here are they. Here are they. Not just one, not just a single person. God's going to have friends more than just an Enoch.
Amen.
He's going to have more than just an Abraham in his day. He's going to have more than just a Daniel in Babylon in his day. God is going to have a group of people. He's going to have a group of saints. And here are they that keep the commandments of God and have the faith of Jesus. There is a direct relationship between what Jesus is doing today in heaven, in the heavenly sanctuary, and what his people are doing upon this earth. I'd like to share a few inspired statements with you. This is from the Bible Commentary, but the Ellen G. White Comments, Volume 7, page 933. This is the great day of atonement, and our advocate is standing before the Father, pleading as our intercessor. In place of wrapping about us the garments of self-righteousness, we should be found daily humbling ourselves before God, confessing our own individual sins, seeking the pardon of our transgressions, and cooperating with Christ in the work of preparing our souls to reflect the divine image. Let me just pause there. If we are reflecting the divine image, what does that mean about our character and his character? One becomes then the mirror image of the other. Unless we enter the sanctuary above and unite with Christ in working out our own salvation with fear and trembling, we shall be weighed in the balances of the sanctuary and shall be pronounced wanting. I want to ask you a question. Is that an emphatic statement? It says that unless this happens, we shall be found wanting. It is vital to our experience. In the 1888 materials on page 127, now Christ is in the heavenly sanctuary. And what is he doing? Making atonement for us. Cleansing the sanctuary from the sins of the people. Then we must enter by faith into the sanctuary with him. We must commence the work in the sanctuary of our souls. We are to cleanse ourselves from all defilement. We must cleanse ourselves from all filthiness of the flesh and spirit, perfecting holiness in the fear of God. It says that we enter into this sanctuary how?
By faith.
By faith, just like Colossians 2:6. That's right. Now, one of the most vital messages of the sanctuary doctrine to believers, to us, since 1844, is that something special is required of God's followers in terms of character development that was not so vital to the development of the church before 1844. Don't you get that? There's something that's different today, something that's required today to the development of the character of the church since 1844 that wasn't required before 1844. And why and how could that be? Well, let's just first of all review a point that I think we've heard a few times this week. Christ is waiting with longing desire for the manifestation of himself in his church. When the character of Christ shall be perfectly reproduced in his people, then he will come to claim them as his own. That's an encouraging statement, isn't it? I'm sure that my favorite reformer is Martin Luther. I think Luther was a giant of a man. But I want to tell you something, friends. Luther nor his generation was ready for the coming of Christ. Do you understand that? When Jesus comes back, he's coming back for a people who shall perfectly reproduce his character. And I'm going to tell you, persecuting Sabbath keepers, persecuting the Jews, drinking beer down in the pubs, that doesn't make it in the final generation. John Calvin's having Michael Servetus burned at the stake because he was not a Trinitarian doesn't make it for the last generation. There were some men that are considered great reformers today who lived during the early part of the Reformation and people who lived later years, but their characters, friends, were not the kind of characters that Christ is looking for when he comes back. And there is going to be a difference. There is a difference in what Christ is going to expect in the end time versus what he has been willing to accept before. There should be an urgency gripping us as a people. And I'm not speaking about the regular Seventh-day Adventists. I think Sister Ann used a term the other day. What was it you said? We didn't say the regular Seventh-day Adventists. What was the term you used? I don't remember. The organized. Organized. Friends, we should be organized as a people. Maybe not organized like there, but God should have an organized people, shouldn't he? But there is a legally recognized corpus that I'm not talking about. That's not who I'm talking about. I'm talking about us. There should be an urgency among us as a people. Friends, those people, they got left behind a long time ago. I'm sorry. We need to be looking ahead, not behind. And there's an urgency that we need to get a hold of. Jesus wants to truly bring our lives into conformity with every word of God. And it is a solemn truth that in the entering of the most holy place of the heavenly sanctuary, Jesus began his last phase of mediation for humanity, and that involves a character fitness for the last generation. Now, has there been a delay since 1844? There obviously has, right? Because we said that it should take only what? One generation. Only one generation should have finished the work. And yet, clearly, there has been a delay since 1844. And you remember what happened in 1844? There was a Bible prophecy, and just in case we didn't remember this, in the book of Daniel, in the 8th chapter, and it said that there would be 2,300 prophetic days or literal years from a certain point until the sanctuary in heaven would be cleansed. And if we look at the prophecy, we know that prophecy began in 457 B.C. It extends then down 2,300 years to the year 1844. Something very specific happened in the year 1844, and it was the beginning of the cleansing of the heavenly sanctuary. But there's been, obviously, a change. But friends, this change, this altering, is not due to heavenly inefficiency or a change of his plans. You know, there's a text that I bet every one of you recognize, if I at least give you the reference. Ezekiel chapter 4 and verse 6. Ezekiel chapter 4 verse 6. What does it say? Each day for a year. But isn't there a complementary text we use many times? What is it? Numbers 14:34. But have you ever read the marginal reference for Numbers 14:34? He speaks there at the end, you shall know the breach of my promise. But if you look in the margin, it says altering of my purpose. An altering of my purpose. Was it God's purpose that the children of Israel should have to live in the wilderness for 40 years? Was that the design that he wanted? No. Was it the design that friends, I'm bring this close to home. Was it God's design that we should even be here alive today in the beginning? No, it wasn't. He wanted this work to be finished, and it was going to be finished in a generation. or less. But there had to be a delay. There had to be a certain delay. Because, friends, character is not given. Character is developed, and it takes a time for a generation to develop that character. But we know this, and this is found in Selected Messages, Book 1. Had Adventists, after the great disappointment in 1844, held fast their faith and fought on unitedly in the opening providence of God, receiving the message of the third angel and in the power of the Holy Spirit proclaiming it to the world, they would have seen the salvation of God. The Lord would have wrought mightily with their efforts. The work would have been completed, and Christ would have come ere this, and she wrote this in 1883, he would have come ere this to receive his people to their reward. But in the period of doubt and uncertainty that followed the disappointment, many of the Advent believers yielded their faith. Had the whole Advent body united upon the commandments of God and the faith of Jesus, how widely different would have been our history. Isn't that an amazing statement? There's a lot of talk about unity today, friends, but I'm going to tell you something. If unity avoids the commandments of God or the faith of Jesus, it's not the unity that we need. She says, it was not the will of God that the coming of Christ should be thus delayed. God did not design that his people, Israel, should wander 40 years in the wilderness. He promised to lead them directly to the land of Canaan and establish them there in a holy, healthy, happy people. But those to whom it was first preached went not in because of unbelief. Their hearts were filled with murmuring, rebellion, and hatred, and he could not fulfill his covenant with them. She continues, for 40 years did unbelief, murmuring, and rebellion shut out ancient Israel from the land of Canaan. The same sins have delayed the entrance of modern Israel into the heavenly Canaan. In neither case were the promises of God at fault. It is the unbelief. But you know, she doesn't stop there with unbelief. Notice what else she says. The worldliness, unconsecration, and strife among the Lord's professed people that have kept us in this world of sin and sorrow so many years. In fact, a few years after this, in 1901, Ellen White wrote a letter to Percy T. McGann. And in that letter, she said this, we may have to remain here in this world because of insubordination many more years, as did the children of Israel. But for Christ's sake, his people should not add sin to sin by charging God with the consequences of their own wrong course of action. And if you will look carefully, you'll see the dating of that letter. Isn't that an interesting date? Mm-hmm. December the 7th, 2000, or 1901. What happened exactly 40 years later?
Pearl Harbor.
What if we had done our work, friends? Would Pearl Harbor have ever happened? No. World War II would have never happened. World War I would have never happened. God wants to finish the work of sin in this universe. And according to Nahum 1:9, I think it was quoted last night, he's going to do that. But for him to do that, friends, he must finish sin in us. He must finish sin in us. Let's turn to Zechariah chapter 10. Zechariah chapter 10 and verse 1. He says, ask ye of the Lord rain in the time of the latter rain, so the Lord shall make bright clouds and give them showers of rain to everyone grass in the field. Friends, do you think that we should be asking for the latter rain? Should we be praying for the latter rain? Don't you want to be experiencing the latter rain? I believe with all my heart that God longs to pour out the latter rain upon his people. He wants to do that. He wants to pour out the latter rain on those who have cleansed the soul temple of every defilement. 5 T 2:14. He longs for his people, friends, to be so settled into the truth, so comfortable with his way of life. Now, you know, we have people today who get comfortable with their way of life, right? They get really comfortable, and they don't want to change things. But God wants the people who can become comfortable, but comfortable with His way of life, and with His way of life so much that He can impart His seal of approval and point to them without any embarrassment. And He can say, here are they that keep the commandments of God and the faith of Jesus. Now, I said earlier that there's a principle, and that is that this generation is going to be held to a higher standard, to a higher accountability, at least those generations that have lived since 1844. And basic to the Adventist thought, for more than a century, have been the twin concepts of a cleansed sanctuary in heaven and a prepared, spotless people upon the earth. And I'd just like to share a little bit of history for a few minutes on that to verify that. If we go back to the year 1850, Elder Joseph Bates, writing in the Advent Review and Sabbath Herald, he said, and he's quoting here from Leviticus 16:16, "He shall make an atonement for the holy because of the uncleanness of the children of Israel and because of their transgressions and all their sins." And he says, "Will the reader please read these 18 words again and see if he cannot tell the meaning of the cleansing of the sanctuary?" "Oh, yes, you say it was to cleanse the people, all of them, from their sins." "Very well, do not forget it when it comes down to you and the Antitype." Something going on in heaven that affects us on earth. In 1856, Stephen Haskell, also writing in the Advent Review and Sabbath Herald of November 6, 1856, he saw a clear connection between a people prepared for the coming of Jesus and the completion of the gospel work. He said this, "A theory of the third angel's message never will save us without the wedding garment, which is the righteousness of the saints. We must perfect holiness in the fear of the Lord." But I think one of the most remarkable series was actually written by Daniel Bordeaux. He wrote a series of articles in 1864 that was published in a review, and later was put in a book, Sanctification or Living Holiness. And these articles, they mention a special responsibility resting upon the final generation. Bordeaux says this, "But some do not see the necessity of receiving the truths applicable to the present time in order to be sanctified. They think they can be sanctified by living as other good Christians have lived." Now, what's that making a reference to then? Past time. "But how have good Christians in the past been sanctified? Have they not been sanctified by living up to the light that they had in their day? And if we are favored with more light than they were, if God has other duties for us to perform, can we be sanctified by merely living as they lived? Does God cause light to shine on His word in vain?" Are you starting to get it? Are those gears starting to move in your head now? Are you getting what I'm making a point here too? He goes on to say, "It will require a special preparation to meet the Lord when He comes. It will be necessary for the last church to look for Christ, for it is to them that look for Him that He will appear the second time without sin unto salvation." Bordeaux is saying, look, this final generation, you've had more light. And friends, since 1844, we've had greater light, much greater light than any other generation. More light than Martin Luther had. More light than John Wesley had. More light than John Calvin had. Or any of those reformers. And because you are sanctified according to living up to the light that you have, if you have more light, friends, more is going to be required of you. More is going to be required. This principle was developed further by W.W. Prescott. And at the 1903 General Conference, he was preaching and he said these words, "But there is a difference between the forgiveness of sins and the blotting out of sin. There is a difference between the gospel being preached for the forgiveness of sins and the gospel being preached for the blotting out of sin. Always and today, there is abundant provision for the forgiveness of sins." And then he continues, "In our generation comes the provision for the blotting out of sin. And the blotting out of sin is what will prepare the way for the coming of the Lord. And the blotting out of sin is the ministry of our high priest in the most holy place of the heavenly sanctuary." And it makes a difference to the people of God today in their ministry, in their message, and in their experience, whether they recognize the change in the ministry from one apartment to the other, or whether they recognize and experience the fact of the change. And so this concept of increased light and increased responsibility and increased perfection and a more perfectly reflecting of the light and the image of Christ in the final generation becomes clear to us. These concepts were refined and they were expanded by M.L. Andreessen. And I believe M.L. Andreessen was probably the greatest theologian the Adventist Church ever had. But he took these concepts and he refined them, he expanded them. And this thinking became known as final generation theology. Final generation theology. Now, I want to make it very clear. I said to you when we started tonight that you wouldn't hear this at Andrews University unless you hear it in a class where they are talking about what they don't believe. Because they definitely do not believe in any kind of a concept of a final generation. A final generation being perfected and having an experience unique and different and higher than any generation before them. I know that because I've been to Andrews University. I've heard the professors openly state this. They make no bones about it. They're not afraid to tell you that they don't believe in this, that they think it's crackpot theology. But I want to tell you, friends, it's very important theology. Andreessen, he noted that this concept of a final generation in his book, The Sanctuary Service, on pages 113, 114, he said this: "While it is true that many from time to time have dedicated their lives to God and lived without sin for periods of time, Satan claims that these are special cases, as was Job's case, and do not come under the ordinary rules. He demands a clear-cut case where there can be no doubt and where God has not interfered. And now the question is, can such an instance be produced?" And that's what Andreessen's asking now. Satan says, well, maybe there's an individual here or an individual there, but God says he's going to raise up a whole nation. God says he's going to have a righteous people. And I don't think he can do it. And can he do it? And Andreessen said, yes, he can. Now, there's a concept in theology called prevenient grace. And it simply means grace that God bestows to the believer before conversion that enables him to accept the gospel. In other words, if God didn't pour out grace upon us, friends, even before we came to Jesus, we'd never be able to come to him. And Christians freely believe in forgiving grace to cover sins committed in the past, but there's something that Ellen White calls sustaining grace also. Sustaining grace. That is grace that enables us or empowers us to live a righteous life, to live above sin. And this is the grace that enables the believer to live clean before man and God. Sustaining grace. Remember the statement we read earlier from Testimonies of Ministers, page 508? Divine grace is needed at every step, and divine grace alone can complete the work. Here's Andreessen's theology in a nutshell, and I'm going to take a few minutes to read a couple pages from his book, The Sanctuary Service, for you, with you. Again, going back to where we left off, he demands, that's talking about Satan. Satan is demanding a clear-cut case where there can be no doubt and where God has not interfered. Can such an instance be produced? Andreessen says, God is ready for the challenge. Amen? Amen. He has bided his time. The supreme exhibition has been reserved until the final contest. Out of the last generation, God will select his chosen ones. Not the strong or the mighty. Not the honored or the rich, not the wise or the learned, but common, ordinary people will God take and through and by them make his demonstration. Continuing, Satan has claimed that those who in the past have served God have done so from mercenary motives, that God has pampered them, and that he, Satan, has not had free access to them. If he were given full permission to press his case, they also would be won over. But he charges that God is afraid to let him do this. Give me a fair chance, Satan says, and I will win out. And so, to silence forever Satan's charges, to make it evident that his people are serving him from motives of loyalty and right without reference to reward, to clear his own name and character the charges of injustice and arbitrariness, and to show to angels and men that his law can be kept by the weakest of men under the most discouraging and most untoward circumstances. God permits Satan in the last generation to try his people to the utmost. They will be threatened, tortured, persecuted. They will stand face to face with death in the issuance of the decree to worship the beast and his image. But they will not yield. They are willing to die rather than to sin. Andreessen continues, God removes his spirit from the earth. Satan will have a greater measure of control than he has ever had before. True, he may not kill God's people, but that seems to be the only limitation. And he uses every permission he has. He knows what is at stake. It's now or never. And before I continue with Andreessen's quote, I want to share with you a short experience I had. I suppose it's been 35 years ago. I was sitting in the balcony of a large conference church, and we were in a Sabbath school class. And the conference evangelist's wife was sitting about two chairs from me. And she says, you know, we can never overcome sin in this world. And someone beside her said, that's right. You know, but I believe that when we get to heaven and we're not tempted any longer, we'll be able to overcome sin then. And she said, yeah, I think that's right. When all the temptation's taken away and our natures have been changed, then we'll be able to obey God's law. And that's what Jesus will do for us when he comes back. And this is what was being said. But you see, the theology that Andreessen's proposing here, can you see it's the exact opposite? God is not proposing, friends, to have a group of people who have to have everything taken away that's difficult or hard to live victorious. He's saying that my grace is so great, my empowering grace is so great that I can take the weakest of the weak and I can put them into the strongest of the strongest flak and fire, and they're still going to walk victoriously. That's exactly what he says. Continuing with Andreessen, he says, God, to make the demonstration complete, does one more thing. He hides himself. The sanctuary in heaven is closed. The saints cry to God day and night for deliverance, but he appears not to hear. God's chosen ones are passing through Gethsemane. They are having a little taste of Christ's experience those 3 hours on the cross. Seemingly, they must fight their battles alone. They must live in the sight of a holy God without an intercessor. Though Christ has finished his intercession, the saints are still the object of God's love and care. Holy angels watch over them. God provides them shelter from their enemies. You know, in Psalms 46, God is our refuge and strength, a very present help. But you know, that word refuge, it could be translated shelter. He's our shelter. He protects us. He provides them with food and shields them from the destruction and supplies grace and power for holy lives, referring to Psalms 91. Yet they are still in the world, still tempted, afflicted, tormented. Will they stand the test? To human eyes, it seems impossible. If only God would come to their rescue, all would be well. They are determined to resist the evil one. If need be, they will die, but they will not sin. Satan has no power and never has had to make any man sin. He can tempt, he can seduce, he can threaten, but he cannot compel. And now God demonstrates through the weakest of the weak that there is no excuse, never has been any, for sinning. If men in the last generation can successfully repel Satan's attack, if they can do this with all the odds against them and the sanctuary closed, what excuse is there for men's ever sinning? In the last generation, God gives the final demonstration that men can keep the law of God and that they can live without sinning. God leaves nothing undone to make the demonstration complete. The only limitation put upon Satan is that he may not kill the saints. He may tempt them, he may harass and threaten them. He does his best, but he fails. He cannot make them sin. They stand the test, and God puts his seal upon them. In our last paragraph beginning, it says, through the last generation of saints, God stands finally vindicated. Through them, he defeats Satan and wins his case. They form a vital part of the plan of God. They go through terrific struggles. They battle with unseen powers in high places. But they have put their trust in the Most High, and they will not be ashamed. They have suffered hunger and thirst, but now they shall hunger no more, neither thirst any more, neither shall the sun light on them, nor any heat. For the Lamb which is in the midst of the throne shall feed them, and shall lead them into living fountains of water, and God shall wipe away all tears from their eyes. And he's quoting there from Revelation chapter 7. In other words, Andreessen, he completely and totally rejected the concept that sin is inevitable and unavoidable. Simply just because we say we are humans or that we are weak humans. And why did he do that? He rejected it basically upon one fundamental truth, and that is that we have an all-atoning sacrifice and an all-powerful mediator. Amen. That Jesus' grace is enough to forgive us of our sins of the past and enough to keep us from sinning in the future. Some of you remember Elder W.D. Frazee. I know Brother Mac knows Elder Frazee, knew Elder Frazee. He was fond of saying that the sanctuary one day will shut down. You know why he said that? He said, it shuts down for lack of business. Lack of business. In other words, friends, the saints have come to that place where their characters perfectly reflect the image of Christ. And so the eschatology of this all fits in to the Christology and the soteriology of the Bible. The wicked, on one hand, will have reached what we call the point of no return. They will reach the point of no return where they will never ever become righteous. They will always stay wicked. They will stay embedded in that kind of a way. But just as they have become embedded and fixed, and they've reached a point of no return, the righteous have reached a point of no return also. Because the ministry of Christ in the heavenly sanctuary, they have reached a point of no return. We've been told that just as soon as the people of God are sealed in their foreheads, it is not any seal or mark that can be seen, but a settling into the truth, both intellectually and spiritually, so that they cannot not be moved. Just as soon as God's people are sealed and prepared for the shaking, it will come. She says, indeed, it has already begun. In other words, friends, we are sealed. We are settled in the truth in such a way, not only intellectually, but experientially, that we cannot be moved. Does it work? Can God do this? Friends, he's promised to do it. He says that he will have a man more precious than the fine golden wedge of ophir. He says that he will have a righteous nation that keeps the truth. The Bible says that if any man sin, we have an advocate with the Father, Jesus Christ, the righteous. The Bible says, now unto him that is able to keep you from falling and to present you faultless. Remember we studied about perfection on Tuesday night, and the term perfection and perfect, that one of the basic fundamental definitions of being perfect or having perfection is to have no faults, to be without fault, and to present you faultless before the throne of his glory with exceeding joy. Let's turn to Hebrews chapter 10. I think Fred was referring to this text this morning. Hebrews chapter 10, and we'll begin at verse 19. And I think the sun set, but you know, I want to keep the atmosphere of the Sabbath just a little longer. That's okay. We need that tonight. Hebrews chapter 10, verse 19. It says, having therefore, brethren, boldness to enter into the holiness by the blood of Jesus, by a new and living way which he hath consecrated for us through the veil, that is to say what? His flesh, friends, there's something about his flesh that has given us a new and living way that provides salvation in a special way. Didn't we talk about the incarnation some last night? And this importance of understanding that Jesus walked as we walk? In verse 21, and having a high priest over the house of God, let us draw near with a true heart in full assurance of faith, having our hearts sprinkled from an evil conscience and our bodies washed with pure water. Because of the coming of Christ in the flesh, we have a new way opened for access to God. A new way, a way not opened before, where we can have unlimited power to overcome. The Bible says that Jesus condemns sin in the flesh, doesn't it? Do you remember where it says that? Romans chapter 8. It says that he condemns sin in the flesh. But you know what he wants to do? He wants to do it again. Do you know whose flesh he wants to do it in? In us. In our flesh. He wants to condemn sin again. And he can do that. And he's able to do it. To claim the name of Jesus, though, To claim the name of Jesus without claiming his power, friends, is not only an embarrassment to God, but it's a major barrier to salvation. I hear people say sometimes, well, you know, look, you're not sinless, I'm not sinless. Can you tell me someone who is sinless? I've made mistakes, you've made mistakes. I don't have the faith I need. But you know, there's a common thread through all those statements. And someone mentioned it the other night, and it involves I. I don't have this, I don't have it. Well, that's fine. That's not the problem. The problem is not what we don't have. The problem is that we don't recognize what Jesus has. The issue really should be, do we have a sinless Savior? Do we have an all-powerful mediator? Is Christ able to save to the uttermost? Is Christ able to keep you from falling? And that's the questions we need to answer. And you know, the answer to every one of those is yes. The answer to everyone is yes. In Romans chapter 3. Romans chapter 3. Verse 25 and 26. I'll read verse 24. Being justified freely by his grace through the redemption that is in Christ Jesus. Now verse 25. Whom God has set forth to be a propitiation through faith in his blood, to declare his righteousness for the remission of sins that are past through the forbearance of God, to declare, I say at this time, his righteousness, that he might be just and the justifier of him that believeth in Jesus. Now notice, friends, he's not only justifier, but he is what? He's just in doing it. In other words, it's a proper legal right transaction. God has every right to forgive us our sins. He has every right to empower us to live differently than we've lived in the past because of what Jesus has done for us. Jesus came to reveal the Father to us. In Desire of Ages on page 671, the Savior came to glorify the Father by the demonstration of his love. So the Spirit was to glorify Christ by revealing his grace to the world. The very image of God is to be reproduced in humanity. The honor of God, the honor of Christ, is involved in the perfection of the character of his people. That should be enough. If it's only that, that should motivate us, because we love God, to want to live the right kind of life, that should be enough. I don't know about you guys, you men, but I take my mother pretty seriously. Amen. My mother's still living, bless her heart. She's turned 80 years old. In fact, I missed her 80th birthday because of this camp meeting. Hi, Mom. I love you. She's listening tonight, or was. But I dare say that if someone spoke very harshly and unfairly and rudely about my mother, I'd probably stand up and say something. Mm-hmm. Yeah. I'd hope I could say it in the right way, but it wouldn't go with silence. Because I appreciate her, and I will honor her. And her honor is important to me. But you know, friends, as much as I love my mother, as much as I love you, Mom, I love my Lord Jesus Christ more. And I know that's okay with you. If we love the Lord Jesus Christ, we would stand up and we would defend our daughters, guys. We would defend our wives. We would defend our mothers. Aren't we interested in the honor of God? I am. In Job chapter 23. Job chapter 23 and verse 10. But he knoweth the way that I take. When he hath tried me, I shall come forth as gold. Is that the experience that you want tonight? That's the experience that I want tonight. Making reference to this text in the book Education, Ellen White says, so it came to pass, by his patience endurance, he that is Job, vindicated his own character, and thus the character of him whose representative he was. And the Lord turned the captivity of Job. Also the Lord gave Job twice as much as he had before, so the Lord blessed the latter end of Job more than his beginning. Someone said something about habits earlier. Was that you, Morgan? You said something about habits. I'm glad you did that, because I've got a couple statements I want to share with you. In Christ Object Lessons on page 356, actions repeated form habits, habits form characters, or character, and by the character our destiny for time and for eternity is decided. So we need to understand more about habits, don't we? We need to have our experience in a habitual way. And we've been told that in the book Amazing Grace, page 235. The grace of Christ must mold the entire being, and its triumph will not be complete until the heavenly universe shall win habitual tendencies of feeling, Christ-like love, and holy deeds in the deportment of the children of God. In other words, friends, it's not just something we do once in a while. It becomes habitual. If something's habitual, what does that mean?
Every day.
It's a habit. It's what we do. It's what we do. She also says this in Ministry of Healing. It's a good book. If you've not read it, I'd recommend you read it. Page 491. That which at first seems difficult, by constant repetition, grows easy until right thoughts and actions become what? Habitual. Those of you who have ever played the piano, you know what I mean when I talk about muscle memory. You know what muscle memory is. You know, you move those fingers on the keys so many times that you don't have to think about it after a while. It just happens. It's like when you're typing, you learn to type at first. You know, well, the A is here, the S is here, the T is here, or R is here. But after a while, you start doing like this. And you're not thinking for every individual finger. It just happens. There's muscle memory. It becomes habitual in you because you've practiced through repetition over and over. And friends, we need to understand that God wants us to form habits of doing the right things and to become habitual in the right ways. It says, if we will, we may turn away from all that is cheap and inferior and rise to a high standard. We may be respected by men and beloved of God. And how many generations does it take to see that happen, friends?
Only one.
I like this statement. I think you will too. Love is the basis of godliness. What is?
Love.
Jesus said, if you love me, you'll keep my commandments. Whatever the profession, no man has pure love to God unless he has unselfish love for his brother. But we can never come into possession of this spirit by trying to love others. What is needed is the love of Christ in the heart. When self is merged in Christ, love springs forth how? Spontaneously. We could just simply say habitually. It's spontaneous. The completeness of Christian character is obtained when the impulse to help and bless others springs constantly from within. When the sunshine of heaven fills the heart and is revealed in the countenance. Can you say amen to that?
Amen.
That's the kind of experience that I need tonight. I need that kind of experience where I love God so much that there just is within my heart a wellspring of wanting to do something good to bless others. Because when I've learned to love my brother, I've already learned to love the God that I don't see. I've got to learn to love my brother that I see. But I do that by learning to love the God I don't see first. And we can do that because the Bible says so. Inspiration has promised it. And it's sure. And you know what, friends? We are in the last generation. We are in the last generation. And I assure you that there's going to be a generation from us who are here living that's going into the heavenly Canaan without seeing death. The question is, are we going to be a part of it or not? It's true. There are some of us who are a little older than others. And they may not live quite that long. We don't know. But you know, we have a promise. All who have died in the faith of the third angel's message, friends, will be in that special resurrection. And they'll see Jesus come. And we can all be united together. In perfect harmony. In perfect unity at that time. Because we have come into that conformity now. During probationary time. God wants it for each one of us, friends. He wants it for you. He wants it for me.
Soon we'll come to the end of life's journey. And perhaps we'll never meet anymore till we gather in heaven's bright city. Far away on that beautiful shore, if we never meet again this side of heaven, as we struggle through this world and its strife. There's another meeting place somewhere in heaven. By the beautiful river of life, where the charming roses bloom forever, and separations come no more. If we never meet again this side of heaven, I will meet you on that beautiful shore.